Welcome to worship at the Lutheran Church of the Good Shepherd in Holmdel, New Jersey. Today, our worship team includes Clem Hergenhan, our lay reader and assisting minister, Miae Park, our minister of music, and I'm Pastor Pat Medley. This is the second Sunday of Easter. Did you know there were seven? We get a whole week of Easters. It only makes sense that, you know, we had 40 days of repenting and mourning our sins, but we get 50 days of rejoicing and Easter. And today, we get the most wonderful story of Jesus appearing to terrified disciples who've already heard Mary Magdalene say, "I've seen the Lord," but it seems to make no impact on them. But when Jesus shows up and shows them his wounds, then they really rejoice. And we do as well, because we know when we show up, our Lord shows up. We begin our service with the prelude. Please rise as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter and our joy. Amen. Look, here is water. Here is our water of life. Alleluia. Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deep and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is water. Here is our water of life. Alleluia. At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you through the risen Christ, our source of living water, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Look, here is water. Here is our water of life. Alleluia. Our entrance hymn is hymn number 365, Jesus Christ is risen today.
Triumphant, holy day.
Lord's resurrection. By the grace of Christ among us, enable us to show the power of the resurrection, all that we say and do, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading.
First lesson is from Acts chapter 4. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 133 responsively. How good and how pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity.
It is like fine oil upon the head, flowing down upon the beard of Aaron, flowing down upon the collar of his robe.
It is like the dew of Hermon flowing down upon the hills of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. The second lesson is from 1 John chapter 1. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it. And declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not have sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain any, they are retained." But Thomas, was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. This is our time for children and all who are young at heart. So good morning, friends. Anybody young at heart? Well, we'll work at it. Okay. So I have a question for you. How do you recognize someone? How do you know it's really that person you think you know?
See the face.
The face, right? The eyes, the expression. If they say hello to you and they know your name, that's always a good sign, right? Their voice, absolutely their voice. Maybe they have a mole or a birthmark, or in Jesus' case, he had wounds. Everybody knew he had been crucified. But if someone had died, would you even expect to see them? No, dead is dead. Dead is dead. Yes, that was what it was like for Jesus' followers. Jesus had died with his hands nailed to a cross, and they were afraid it could happen to them too, so they were hiding behind locked doors, which I think is pretty smart. After Jesus had died, just to test, is he really dead? A soldier had stuck a spear in Jesus' belly. Poor Jesus. His disciples gathered and locked the door in fear, but just then, Sunday, Jesus showed up. He greeted them just like always. "Shalom, peace be with you." Everyone said that. But not everyone entered a room when the doors were locked and just showed up like that. Was it really Jesus who had died? He showed them his boo-boos, his hands where the nails had been, and his belly too. He showed them that. Then they were really happy. God had made Jesus alive again. They knew this was really, truly Jesus, and not someone pretending to be Jesus. Nobody else would have boo-boos like these. Then Jesus did something really special. He breathed Easter life into them. And he told them it was the Holy Spirit he was giving them, God's life. Just as God had sent Jesus into the world, Jesus was sending his followers into the world. He told them,
"Peace be with you," they would not have to be afraid. They were filled with God's love and given the power to share forgiveness and the good news of Easter with all the world. One of the disciples, Thomas, was not there on that Sunday when this happened. Thomas missed it. So they were excited to tell him that they had seen the Lord alive again. Thomas said, "Only the Jesus who had died for him, one with real boo-boos that he could see and touch with his own hands, would do." Was Thomas being silly? No, he was right. He would not accept a ghost, a fake Jesus, a pretend Jesus, a substitute. And the very next Sunday, when Thomas was there, Jesus showed up again. He told Thomas, "Go ahead, touch my boo-boos," because they were real and he's real. "Don't doubt, don't be without faith, believe," Jesus said. Thomas said something very beautiful and important. He called Jesus my Lord and my God. Jesus laughs and says that Thomas now believes because he's seen for himself. But he did not believe only when he'd been told the truth by others. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. Who does that describe? Who has not seen Jesus risen with his...
Us,
all of us, that's right. You all have the right answers, yes. We have not seen the risen Lord because he's gone on to heaven. Yet we are blessed because we've come to believe that Jesus is God's Son, the Messiah, and so we get to have an Easter life in his name. John, who wrote all these things to save them for us to know about them, writes that he did not tell all the stories that there are about Jesus. But he writes these things just for that reason, so that knowing Jesus, boo-boos and all, we can have the gift of a wonderful new Easter life. When God gives us a new Easter life, there's no kind of boo-boo that can take it away. And in heaven, there are no boo-boos at all. We can be really excited to tell people who missed gathering with us today what we heard and how we celebrated Jesus' loving presence with us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. I give you thanks and praise for the evangelists and for the disciples who treasured their eyewitness experiences of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Grant now that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So I've always felt badly for Thomas the twin, the disciple featured so prominently in today's gospel, because there's a lot to love about Thomas. When Jesus tells the disciples that he's going to his father's house to prepare a place for them, and that they know where he's going, it's Thomas who speaks up and admits his own confusion, when certainly the others are just as bewildered, but have trouble admitting it. He says, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" And that wonderful question leads to Jesus' reply, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you'll know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Jesus makes it clear, he and the Father are one. And Thomas is brave. When Jesus tells the disciples he's planning to go to Judea again, the other disciples warn him not to do it, saying, "Rabbi, The Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again? When Jesus explains he's going to awaken Lazarus from death, Thomas encouraged his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." I have to wonder if Thomas is not with the other disciples behind locked doors as our gospel begins on that Easter night, in fear for their lives, right? Because he was just not that kind of guy. Not the fearful type. He often gets called doubting Thomas. Yet we don't call the other disciples hiding in fear doubting disciples. Mary Magdalene, the first apostle commissioned by the Lord to give the Easter message, had announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," but that seems to have made no impact on them. They only rejoiced after they heard Jesus wishing them peace and showing them his hands and his side. Let's be fair. So far, seeing is believing. And John's gospel is filled with the word look and the verb see. John the Baptist says, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." When Philip tells Nathanael they found the one about whom Moses and the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, and Nathanael retorts, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip responds, "Come and see, come and see." When the Samaritan woman at the well discovers that Jesus is the Messiah and rushes into town to proclaim him, she says, "Come and see a man who told me everything I've ever done." When Thomas misses the opportunity to see Jesus on Easter night and to therefore believe that he is risen, he only asks to see what the other disciples have already seen. Thomas is clear about it. He will accept only Jesus Christ crucified and risen. And almost like an answered prayer, that is what he will get. The Lord Jesus who died for him. What else could anyone want? Did you notice that the disciples always gather and Jesus always shows up on a Sunday? We, the church, are being schooled. The creeds have not yet been written, but they are already being shaped. Christians began to gather on Sunday, the day of the Lord's resurrection. If we neglect to gather, we risk missing what is essential to the sustenance of our faith. Here we see the communion of saints. Jesus shows up every time, each Sunday, with an abundance of love. Did you notice that they also share the peace with one another? The Roman peace, Pax Romana, was the absence of war accomplished through occupation, conquest, weapons, intimidation of enemies. Christ's shalom means that he has fought our battle for us. Death has been conquered, and we have been welcomed into a new kind of justice in the kingdom of heaven. Peace be with you. He does not berate them for the ways they fell short as he was arrested, tortured, and crucified. Surely when Jesus announces peace to them, he also communicates the forgiveness of sins. When Jesus shows them his hands and his side, he demonstrates life everlasting. When he commissions them to announce the forgiveness which he has won by dying on the cross for this world God loves so much, he gives them the power of his endless life, the Holy Spirit breathing Easter life, almost like artificial respiration, upon his church, to equip us to take up the mission his Father gave him. He is spreading Easter life, and it's breaking out all over. Now, this life in his kingdom has been entrusted to the church to share with everyone, no exceptions. Thomas missed all this. The disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." "Darn it, we missed it too. We were not there." I always wondered who Thomas's twin was. Perhaps we are Thomas's twins. When Jesus shows up on the next Sunday, he already knows what Thomas said he needed. And he invites Thomas not only to see, but also touch his wounds. "Do not be without faith. Believe." Do you think Thomas actually reached into Jesus' side or had to put his finger in the stigmata left by the nail in his hands? If he did, it was to worship. In awe, he exclaims, "My Lord and my God." Remember how Jesus had promised him that to see him is to see the Father, right? Perhaps this conversation finds its way into believing Thomas's confession of faith. It's pretty awesome. Then Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." This message is no doubt to us. John's gospel was the last of the four canonical gospels which have survived. It was written when many of the eyewitnesses were dying. John, no doubt, preserved and treasured this story because he understood that our risen Lord's words of blessing given to those who have not seen and yet believe would comfort and strengthen the infant church in its struggle, not only to come to believe that Jesus, God incarnated, crucified, and risen, is God's gift of grace and salvation for us, but also to encourage us to share this gospel with those who have never laid eyes upon Jesus at all. This is our blessing. John's conclusion is this: Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The word for life here is not the word for biological life. There are actually three Greek words, bios, psyche, and zoe is this one. So it's not just being able to fog a mirror, that's the bios life. It's the word for life which is really God-given life in all its fullness, filled with shalom, the peace which is beyond all human understanding. I love that Thomas is not ashamed to ask for what he knows he needs. Coming to faith is a process. I like to say God's not finished with me yet. Thomas is looking to see evidence. We are not a church born of lies or rumors. I love what happens when we show up and discover that Jesus already knows our needs and is hastening to meet them and show himself. Because I am, and we all are sinners, I love seeing him come back from death, having beat the power of sin, death, and the devil at their own game. And the amazing grace he's won for us. I love the intimacy with which Jesus reveals himself to the church, gives us a peace that nothing can destroy, and fills us with Easter life and the gift of the Holy Spirit to live like Jesus in love. I love it that we as Easter people can defy death by living life to the full and loving all people with abandon. And I love it when people who know that Christ crucified has been raised to life to guide and reign over his church cannot shut up about it. Doubting Thomas became believing Thomas. Are you his twin? Let us join him in proclaiming the resurrection. Alleluia! Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Our hymn of the day is hymn number 363, Come You Faithful, Raise the Strain.
Come you faithful, raise the strain of triumph and gladness.
God has moved his triumph into joy from sadness. Lose from Pharaoh's bitter yoke, Jacob's sons and daughters. Let them set foot through
rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear. Let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Your church cries out, O God, and you listen. As you drew near to the disciples, draw near to us this day. Breathe on us, your Holy Spirit, that our faith is renewed and we witness to your love. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your creation cries out, O God, and you listen. Nurture trees, crops, wild flowers, and all growing things. Guide farmers, gardeners, arborists, and others who tend the soil and nurture plants into life. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your world cries out, O God, and you listen. Guide police, firefighters, paramedics, and other first responders to work for the well-being of communities and the dignity of every person, that no one may need to live in fear. We especially pray for peace in Haiti, Burma, Gaza, the Holy Land, and Ukraine. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your children cry out, O God, and you listen. Hear your people crying out for justice, for an end to racism and other oppression, and for a world where all are fed and safe. We pray for all who cry out in suffering or pain. We pray for all those who struggle with unemployment, underemployment, crushing debt, anxiety, depression, infertility, addiction, anger, management problems, battering, abuse, dementia, those who perished or were injured in the collapse of the Francis Scott Key Bridge and the earthquake in Taiwan this week, and all on our prayer list. Former President Jimmy Carter and his family, Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin, Presiding Bishop Elizabeth Eaton, Presiding Bishop of the Episcopal Church Michael Curry, King Charles and Princess Catherine of England, Josh, Caitlin, Patricia, Barbara and Jack, Harold, Francine, Sung Oak, Nancy, Lillian and Mike, Terry, Cindy, Kaylee, Ed, Inge, Michelle, Megan, Matthew, Cole, Kevin, Tillian, Lloyd, Kathy, Lucy, Pastor Bruce, Michael, Isaiah, Dolores, Pastor Jack, Katie and Jenny, Amparo, Heidi, Dr. Caulfrey, Nindy, Dawn, Michael, Courtney, Pam, Sue, Bunny, Bob and Vivian, Bob, Inez and Frank, Gil and especially Patty, Jackson, Lynn and Gary, Chris, Phyllis, Jennifer, the McKnight family, Glenn, all those with flu, COVID, and respiratory illness, and those we name in our hearts. We pray for all those we love. We pray for those against whom our hearts are hardened. We pray for ourselves, trusting your will for us. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your congregations cry out, O God, and you listen. Renew and bless pastors, deacons, musicians, altar guild members, and other staff, administrators, and volunteers who facilitated Holy Week and Easter worship. Open our hearts to discern where God calls each of us to serve, and inspire us as we take up our own ministries with joy. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your people cry out in thankfulness for all the blessings you have poured out upon us, especially during the past week, for the gift of salvation through your Son, for love in all its forms, laughter, joyous gatherings, for healings and answered prayers, for generosity, caring, kindness, goodness, and opportunities to share the bounty you give us, we praise you. God of grace, hear our prayer. Accept our gratitude, O God, for the lives of those who now rest in you, especially Dietrich Bonhoeffer, whom we remember today, and and all whose lives have been given in faithfulness to the gospel. We give thanks for those who have recently died, Donald, Janice, Susan, Dick, Rebecca, Alexei, Navalny, and our loved ones. Grant us your peace amid our fears. God of grace, hear our prayer. Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen. Let's rise. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
We love you. And also with you. Right back at you. Our service continues with the offering and the special music, Lo, in the Grave He Lay.
Thank you.
and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now, a blessing for our virtual worshipers. The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope, bless you now and always. Amen. Amen. Our sending hymn is hymn number 376, Thine is the Glory. Go in peace, rejoice, and be glad. Thanks be to God.